Good morning. Today we have the class on diagnosis and advanced diagnostic aids in periodontics. So to start with the learning outcomes, it is to identify the various advanced diagnostic methods, to describe the principles behind these advanced diagnostic aids, list the recent advanced chairside diagnostic techniques and the frequently used chairside techniques. These are the contents of the lecture, which includes introduction, steps in establishing the diagnosis, the armamentarium required and the examination which we do. Then we discuss about the advanced diagnostic aids in four different forms: clinical diagnosis, radiographic assessment, microbiological analysis, characterizing the host response, and we finish it with a conclusion. So to start with, the word diagnosis is a Greek word which means to dia is to split and gnosis is to learn. This is the art of being able to separate one condition from another condition. Edward Zegerle has correctly said it is the ability and skill of the clinician to detect, recognize and know the nature of the disease process. So this has to have the previous clinical experience along with the current concepts of etiology and pathogenesis to arrive at a diagnosis. There are certain practical purposes of diagnosis as well, such as it is helpful for treatment planning, establishing prognosis, communication, and also reassures the investigators in research setting that they are all studying the same disease. Now, what are the steps in establishing a diagnosis? The main steps include having a good patient rapport, collecting the chief complaint from the patient, collecting the history of present illness from the patient, the medical and dental history, examination, and go on with examination of intra and extra oral examination. After receiving all these data, we review the data and go on with the provisional diagnosis first, after which we have a set of differential diagnosis also. Then we go on with the clinical testing, laboratory testing, and the imaging test studies. With all these together, with the examination, with the history, examination and the investigations together, we come about with a definitive diagnosis. So this is the 1989 classification, which was 1999 classification, which was initially which we followed. Now we go on with the 2017 classification. So the 2017 classification divides the periodontal diseases into periodontal health, gingival diseases and condition, periodontitis and other conditions affecting the periodontium. So we had in class initially telling about the classification of the periodontal diseases, where we have already explained what is gingivitis, what is periodontitis. So gingivitis is nothing but there's an inflammation of the gingiva which is present. That could be either dental biofilm induced, that is plaque induced, or it could be a non-biofilm induced. Periodontitis is nothing but it is an inflammatory disease of the supporting tissues of the periodontium. Again, that could be because of a series of factors involving loss of attachment of the teeth, bone loss, and as well as tissue loss. So that inside that you do have the necrotizing periodontal diseases, periodontitis as a manifestation of systemic diseases. There are also other conditions affecting the periodontium. This classification has another entry as well, that is peri-implant diseases and conditions, which includes the peri-implant health, mucositis, peri-implantitis, peri-implant soft and hard tissues. The link is given down, which is directs you to an article which has the classification in detail. You can go through the classification in detail, or there's a class on this already uploaded to you. So now coming on to the armamentarium which is required. So diagnostic methods needs three main things. One is the clinical examination along with the basic armamentarium which we have, the radiographic or the investigations which are required, and of recent the advanced diagnostic methods have also taken a play in supporting the diagnosis. So the clinical requirement includes mouth mirror, probe, explorer, and the clinical examination includes your gingival and periodontal examination. Now coming on to the examination of the periodontium, The examination of the periodontium can be divided into two general categories, that is assessment of inflammation of the five different keys of inflammation, that is rubor, tumor, calor, dolor and functional lesia. Along with this, in case of gingival problems, you will also have certain other factors such as suppuration, bleeding on probing and presence of gingival crevicular fluid. Suppuration is otherwise your pus formation. Bleeding on probing occurs when there is a gingival inflammation. Presence of GCF is more again when there is a gingival inflammation. Next is about the assessment of damage to the periodontal tissues, done either by visual detection of the clinical signs of tissue destruction, measurement of the clinical attachment loss and the radiographic detection of the bone loss. Now moving on to the general examination. So general examination of the gingiva is done with the help of color. The color, normal color, is coral pink in color. Any alterations from this is considered to be abnormal, excepting the physiologic color of melanin pigmentation. Size, usually you have a normal size with the intracellular and the extracellular materials present. If there is any drug induced gingival enlargement or inflammatory gingival enlargement, you have an increase in size of the gingiva. Contour is the S-shaped contouring surface which is present on each of the tooth surface, which is scalloped like this. So during the signs of diseases, the scalloping will be lost. It could be lost during the signs of the diseases. Consistency, generally it is firm and resilient, which tells it is a healthy surface. But in certain cases, like for example, there's an enlargement, so this consistency becomes soggy and puffy. Surface texture, wherein there is orange peel appearance because of the red apex. On egg disease, then the surface texture gets the orange peel appearance tends to go away. The position of the gingiva is on the same level, but if there is going to be any periodontitis or gingivitis, there could be gingival recession. Ease of bleeding and pain is also another factor which we test for the presence of disease. Separation, if there is any pus formation, you do check it with the help of finger holes. Next, coming on to periodontal examination. Generally, for the periodontal examination, we must include the presence of the pockets, the distribution on each tooth surface, the pocket depth and the level of attachment on the root, and the type of the pockets, either it is suprabony or infrabony. So you can see here that we are going to see what is the clinical attachment level. Generally, clinical attachment level is measured from the CEJ to the depth of the pocket. So that is how we measure clinical attachment level, whereas pocket is measured from the gingival margin to the depth of the pocket. So we have another two factors which we see in case of periodontitis, that is if there is any furcation involvement. So furcation involvement is again divided into class 1, class 2 and class 3 and class 4 based on how the probe enters inside the furcation area. If the furcation area doesn't allow any probe entry, which means that there is bone at the furcation area, so you can see here that there is bone at the furcation area, then it is termed to be class 1 category. So if there is a cul-de-sac effect where the bone is present only on one half of the furcation site, but the probe, it allows entry of the probe but not completely, that is your class 2 defect. So bone entry, so if there is bone completely lost in the furcation area, the probe can enter through and through, as in this diagram where it can enter through and through. So this is a class 3 defect. So when there is a through and through entry with soft tissue recession, then it is a class 4 furcation defect. We will be again taking about furcation in the furcation involvement classes. Next, you have mobility to be checked. Usually it's checked either with the help of gloves or we check it with the backs of the instrument in this way to check the mobility of a tooth. It is graded as 1, 2 and 3 according to Glickman, and we will eventually be learning that as well in the clinics. Mucogingival problem. There are three problems which we will be dealing in the mucogingival sites of the tissues. One could be an inadequate width of attached gingiva. Another could be a shallow vestibule. The third could be the frenum which is interfering with it. So Friedman, he has told that if there is an inadequate width of attached gingiva, there would be it would not allow the subgingival plaque to remove fully because improper pocket closure resulting from the movability of the marginal tissue would occur. So the amount of attached gingiva is generally considered to be insufficient when stretching of the lips or the cheeks induce the movement of the free gingival margin. So this has to be correct. so that the gingiva is not moving always. The marginal gingiva doesn't move always. For that, the attached gingiva has to be of sufficient width. Next, coming on to the intraoral radiographic survey, generally a minimum of 14 IOPAs and 4 posterior bite wing films is considered to be a full set of radiographic survey. So panoramic radiography gives, it's more convenient, it gives more information about the distribution and severity of the bone destruction periodontal disease. However, more details of the bone loss and more details of the presence of the periodontal disease are appreciated with the help of the IOPAs. Next, coming on the advanced diagnostic aids. So we have explained this based on 4 different categories, that is clinical diagnosis, radiographic assessment, microbiological analysis, and categorizing the host response. So starting with the clinical diagnosis, the very first diagnostic aid is the gingival bleeding. Though it is not considered advanced, it is a traditional method of finding the disease. It is a good indicator of the presence of inflammatory lesion in the connective tissue at the base of the sulcus. Polson in 1985 told that bleeding on probing, besides being an indicator of gingival inflammation, it is also an indicator of disease activity. So a normal probing force of 0.25 newton would be sufficient, but more than 0.25 newton itself will result in bleeding in healthy sites. So be careful when you are probing such sites, not more than force, not more than 0.25 newtons to be given. So because of this factor, there may be times that we apply more than the particular force. Bleeding on probing have limited predictive value for the disease progression, but its absence indicates a periodontal healthy status. Next, coming on to the gingival temperature, as an indicator of disease activity, it is being used. Kang et al. Has shown thermal probes are sensitive diagnostic devices as early inflammatory changes are seen in the gingival tissues. Studies suspected that active periodontitis lesions can create measurable elevations in the sulcura temperature. Hafiji has done a study wherein sites with higher temperature were found with red color indication mark were twice at risk for future attachment loss than the green indication one. So this is an advancement wherein you have a periotemp probe. So this could be placed inside the gingival sulcus and they can measure pocket temperature differences as small as 0.1 degree Celsius. Next, coming on to periodontal probing, I think this is, most of you have done already. This is most widely used diagnostic tool for pocket probing. This is crucial and mandatory for diagnosing and evaluating the periodontal therapy. Sensitivity and reproducibility may be a problem but can be achieved. Reading of clinical pocket depth obtained do not normally coincide with the histological pocket depth because while probing clinically, we penetrate only to the coronal level of the junctional epithelium, whereas histological level of probing would go on until the apical end of your junctional epithelium. The disparity between measurements also depends on the probing technique, the angulation, the probing force, the size of the probe used, the angulation which is present, as well as the precision of the probe calibration. So generally, when you have a probe, you have to see that it matches with the National Institute of Dental and Craniofacial Research criteria. So the probes which we use, the conventional probes which we use, also matches the NIDCI category. So precision of NIDCR is around 0.1 mm has to be there. Our probes has 1 mm of precision. They should have a range of 10 mm, probes have ranges of 12 mm. So there should be a constant probing force, but the problem in us that there is no constant probing force, we can probe to any different extent, it is non-standardized. So here there's a problem. Mostly it is a non-invasive procedure, we don't go deep inside the tissues for checking out the probing force and it is easy to access. There is a guidance system in the NIDCR criteria, whereas in case of reading of the probe values, it may vary from subject to subject. And there is a direct electronic recording to be placed in case of NIDCR criteria. But generally, when we record the probes, we do a human voice dictation and recording. So there could be certain human errors which are present. Security. It is complete sterilization is possible, and again this also the instruments also can be easily sterilized. So these are some of the criterias which NIDCR put up, and our probes satisfy most of the criterias. So next, coming on to the five generation of probes. The first generation of probes are the conventional probes or the manual probes with no control forces or automatic data. Examples are the Williams periodontal probe, which we use here, CPITN probe, the WHO probe. Second generation probes are probes with control forces or the pressure sensitive probes, which are the Hunter, TPS, Vine Valley probes and the Yeppel probes. And the third generation of probes are control force probes with automated measurements and computerized data capture. So this is your Florida probe or the improvised Florida, Pasha probe, Interprobe, Perio probe, Foster Miller's probe and the Toronto automated probe. The fourth generation probes are under development and it develops at sequential probe positions along the gingival sulcus. Fifth generation is also under development and has an ultrasonic device which is attached to the fourth generation probe for identifying the attachment level without penetrating it. Next, coming on to the Florida probe, this is a handpiece tip with constant force in use and stent or disc is positioned properly at the top. So this is a probe which is inserted into the oral cavity, the gingival sulcus, and the stent is being positioned at the top. This after the measurement is done, it is connected to the computer to allow the computer to measure the pockets. The Florida Pasha probe has a modified sleeve at which is prominent as 0.125 mm prominent. This is to facilitate its attachment to the CEJ, to catch the CEJ to find the exact clinical attachment level. Next, advantages of the conventional probe over the conventional probe meets the criteria of NIDCR, that is the Florida probe or the other probes which are above the third generation or the second generation. They usually meet the criteria of the NIDCR when an occlusal stent is used as a reference with a probe tip guide. Smooth operation is there, easy to clear and sterilize. Loss of attachment level as small as 99% can be detected, less than 1 mm change. Decreased measurement error for some examiners. It eliminates transcribing problems. Examiner bias can be reduced. 0.1 mm resolution. Because of this level of resolution, normal distributions are closely approximated that are likely to reflect the changes and is measured over the time. So next, coming on to the advances in the radiographic assessment. So the problem with the conventional radiography, which we often use here, is because of the variations in the projection geometry, variation in the contrast density and the masking by anatomic structures. But the advanced diagnostic aids includes the digital radiography, digital subtraction radiography, CADIA, computed tomography, cone beam CT and the tuned aperture computed tomography. The digital radiography. So can you see these images wherein how is this flower and how is this flower? Obviously all will appreciate this flower, I suppose. Again, can you see the image, the IOPA which is present here and here? So obviously everybody would appreciate this image more. So this is what digital radiography is. So the digital image is made up of a large number of discrete picture elements. This size is so small that the image appears smooth at a normal magnification. Size of each pixel in the digital sensors is from 20 to 30 micron. So this is with the help of digital sensors, which would be of two types. One is the solid state detectors, which includes the CCDs, that is charge coupled devices, or the CMOS, complementary metal oxide semiconductors, or the photostimulable phosphor plates. So the advantages of this is that it eliminates the chemical processing of the film, eco-friendly, eliminates the need of darkroom usage, reduces exposure time, provides record storage and allows image quality enhancement either as a whole or in selected regions of interest. Next, coming on to the digital subtraction radiography. This is used to see the changes in the density and the volume of the bone. It could be either qualitative or quantitative. Both of them could be assessed with the help of digital subtraction radiography. So what do we do here? A series of radiographs are taken and they are converted into digital images and they are superimposed on the So a series of radiographs are placed, and this is converted into the digital image, which are superimposed on each other. So it could be a composite image. Supposing if there is bone loss on this series of radiographs, the qualitative quantitative changes could be appreciated. In other words, if we are going to place any bone graft material after treating the patient or after the treatment plan, the bone gain can be seen with the help of a green image. Whereas if there is going to be continuous bone loss in the patient with a series of radiographs, that is, we take a radiograph for around last 2 years, if we have taken radiographs and we compile it one above the other, it would be able to show the bone loss till what level it is right now, how the bone has been lost till this level. So that is what is called as a digital subtraction radiography. So this allows detection of mineral changes as small as 5%. The problem is that it needs a paralleling technique and accurate superimposition. It is coming on to the computer-assisted densitometric image analysis, known as a CADIA. It is a video camera which measures the light transmitted through the radiograph and signals from the camera that is converted into the grayscale. The advantage is that it measures the quantitative changes, bone density over time, higher sensitivity, reproducibility, and accuracy as compared to DSR. Computer tomography, this is the most often used imaging technique nowadays. So it is a digital image which is reconstructed by the computer, which mathematically manipulates the transmission of obtained from the multiple projections. The CT image is recorded and displayed as a matrix of individual blocks known as a voxel or the volume elements. Coming on to the advantages of the computed tomography, this eliminates the superimposition of the images of structures outside the area of interest, so which means that there is no going to be overlapping or masking of images. Differences between the tissue that differ in the physical density by less than 1% also can be distinguished. Data can be viewed as images in the axial, coronal, or the sagittal plane depending on the diagnostic task. It is a multiplanar reformatted imaging. So you can imagine how easy it is to find a lesion or any problem in case of a computer tomography. So its main use is to analyze the available bone for the implant placement, bony or dental pathogenic conditions such as fracture, structural maxillofacial deformity and fracture recognition, and preoperative assessment of impactivity. So these are its uses. Coming on to the advances in the microbiological analysis. So bacteria, microbiological analysis in the sense, you need bacteria for it. Bacteria plays an important role in the initiation and the progression of the disease. So bacteria which is strongly associated with the periodontal disease is your red complex microorganism, that is Porphyromonas gingivalis, Tanarella fasciata, Treponema denticola, and the other microorganism which is important is the A. comitans. So according to the World Workshop 1996, where they had classified the strongly associated and the moderately associated bacteria. So these bacteria, they have a potential when tests are done on the bacteria, such tests have a potential to diagnose various forms of periodontal disease, to serve as indicators of disease initiation and progression, to determine which periodontal sites are at higher risk for active destruction, and can also be used to monitor the periodontal therapy directed at suppression or eradication of the periodontopathogenic microorganisms. So coming on to the bacterial culturing, this is a primary diagnostic method of microbiology used as a tool to determine the cause of the infectious agent by letting the agent to multiply in a predetermined media. So this is considered to be the gold standard till now when determining the performance of a new microbial diagnostic method. Some of its advantages, it said, it gives relative and obsolete counts of cultured species. Only in vitro method, which is able to detect, assess the antibiotic susceptibility of microbes. The disadvantage is that you need growth of live microorganisms, strict sampling and transport conditions, sensitivity of the culture methods is low, culture requires sophisticated methods and relatively time consuming and expensive. So you have certain advances in the microbiological analysis. So we'll go on with the advances. So main category includes your immunodiagnostic methods, enzymatic methods, the molecular microbial analysis. So starting with the immunofluorescence, generally an antibody is labeled with a fluorescent material which is used to detect the presence of an antigen or on a cell or tissue by the fluorescence emitted by the bound antibody. It could be either a direct immunofluorescence method wherein the antibody specific to the antigen is directly tagged with a fluorochrome, so it is actually colored. So if it attaches to the antigen, we will be able to check out with the help of the color, we'll be able to check it out. Indirect immunofluorescence, the antibody specific for antigen is unlabeled, whereas there's a second antiglobulin antibody which is directed towards the first antibody, which is tagged with a fluorochrome. That is the colored agent is a second antibody which is attached to the first antibody and to see its interaction. The cells in the suspension are labeled with the immunofluorescence, and they are directed towards the through the flow cytometer. So when it is directed towards the flow cytometer, there is cell sorting which takes place, and cell analysis and culture takes place later. So by means of this mechanism, we will be able to find the microbiological analysis. Next, coming on to the enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, the basic principle of ELISA is to use an enzyme to detect the binding of the antigen and the antibody. So, an ELISA is used to detect the presence of either antigen or antibody in a sample, depending on how the test is designed. So, it is Evaluside is a Chaside assay for ELISA, and it is able to detect the A. comitans as well as the P. gingivalis. Coming on to the next technique, there is a latex agglutination. The latex beads, so here you can see that the latex beads are coated on the specific antibodies. So you can see the latex beads which are held outside. So when these beads come into specific species in the samples, they bind. That is, when they come into specific species in this sample, they bind like this. So you can see a triangular species here, antigen here, and this antibody or the latex bead is again triangular in shape so that it accommodates this level. Agglutination occurs, clumping of bleeds occurs, and the test is positive, wherein we find that this bacteria is responsible for the particular disease. Next, coming on to the enzymatic methods of bacterial identification, the most used method is the Bana test. So this refers to the enzymatic breakdown of Bana, that is benzoyl D-L-arginine 2-naphthalamine, determines the proteolytic activity of certain anaerobes that contribute to malodor. Patient's saliva is with the bacteria is taken into the Bana testing compound. There's a breakdown of this enzyme, the N-benzoyl enzyme, resulting in biodegradation. There's a change of color which shows that there's a positive reaction. And it is used to identify the volatile sulfur compounds in the halitosis patient. The four bacteria which gives out trypsin-like enzymes and which uses the mechanism of Bana is Phosphatus, Gingivalis, Treponema denticula, and the Caponocytophaga species. So Perioscan is the Chaside's kit which uses the Bana reaction. Next, coming on to the advances in the molecular biology. So of late you would have heard the term polymerase chain reaction more. The basic principle is the analysis of the DNA, RNA, and the protein structure. Hybridization involves pairing of the complementary strands of DNA to produce a double-stranded DNA. Nucleic acid probe, also known as the DNA or the RNA probe, is synthesized artificially and labeled with an enzyme or radioisotope for detection when placed in the plaque sample. So which means that nucleic acid probe plus patient's GCF when they are when it is applied together to the nucleic acid probe, it is flanked by selected primer specific for the target species. There is repeated amplification of that region of DNA which indicates the presence that the target organism is present. So DNA probe, it is the same way where it entails segments of single stranded nucleic acid labeled with an enzyme. So you have an enzyme which is labeled to it. So this when it is able to locate and bind to the complementary nucleic acid sequences, like for example this, when it is able to bind and locate to the other set of sequence of bacterial DNA sequence, and if it is present, then we say it is to be a positive reaction for the presence of bacteria. check about DNA hybridization. It gives simultaneous and quantitative analysis of up to 28 plaque samples, the main advantage being more potential and potential. Next, coming on to the advances in characterizing the host response, it assesses the host response by studying the mediators as a response to specific bacteria or local release of inflammatory mediators or enzymes as a response to infection, which is known as the biomarkers. So these samples could be taken from GCF, saliva, or the blood. So from our GCF, saliva, or blood, if they are able to detect bacteria or the inflammatory immune products, the enzymes from the dead cells, the connective degradation products, or the products of bone resorption. If any of this are able to detect from our GCF, saliva, or blood, then which means that there is a disease process going on in our gums. So this is what is detected with the help of these advanced diagnostic aids. So immune response is detected with the help of antibodies, antigens, and complements, inflammatory mediators such as prostaglandins and cytokines can be detected with the help of them. So enzymes of tissue origin. So you have set a lot of enzymes which are being released when the tissue is getting destructed. The enzyme, the test kit which uses the serum proteinases to be detected is a prognostic. PerioCheck detects the proteases in the GCF. For aspartate, we do check it with the help of the pocket watch. Markers of bone resorption. So when there is bone resorption taking place, there are a series of substances which are released, such as the osteocalcin, bone phosphoprotein, telopeptides of the type 1 collagen, the collagen, proteoglycan, and osteonectins. But unfortunately, they only identify the presence of the disease but do not predict the risk. So they cannot be used as a chalcite kit. But instead, you have matrix metalloproteinases, which is a tissue-borne enzyme. It is a zinc and calcium enzyme. It constitutively formed in the body, secreted by the fibroblast and the macrophages. Normally, it helps in degrading and remodeling of the extracellular matrices. In chronic periodontitis, it has been found that 2, 3, 8, 9, and 13 are the diseased enzymes, which plays an important role in degradation of the collagen fibrils in PDL and bone. MMP-8 is also associated with the attachment loss. So coming on to the gingival crevicular fluid, so there often remains a question, how am I going to take the crevicular fluid out? So this is done with the help of the paper strips. So you can see the paper strips which are inserted inside micropapillary tubes, micropipettes, microsyringes, and the plastic strips. Periotron measures the capacitance across the wet paper strips. So you place the wet paper strip here. It measures the capacitance, which is converted to digital reading. So accordingly, if it is going to be 0 to 20, the reading, then it is said to be in healthy status. If it is like 81 to 200, then it is said to be in severe status. So these are the commercially available kits used to assess the microbial markers. So most of them we have in the previous slides only. Now coming into the conclusion, the eye sees what the mind knows. So data produced by comprehensive examination requires skill and attention to the details of the examiner. Information gathered from history and examination are overwhelming when used correctly with the solution and diagnosis. Skill in diagnostic process requires constant learning. Initial dental student to experienced dental practitioner, constant learning should be there. Thank you.